Nothing like getting refreshed again. Refreshed so we don't get refleshed. Amen. You know, when there are so many things that are happening right now, it's just phenomenal. And the transitions that are going on. And in the transitions, we see not only in our country, but global transitions happening. One of the things that we've got to come to an understanding is that God has the last say.
Amen.
No matter what. Amen? He has the last say. And he's given his people what to say. If we're cooperating. Amen. You know, the Old Testament and the Word of God. Now, this is, again, this is not about religion. Jesus never came to bring religion. He came to bring truth. He came to establish a kingdom. We all were sent from the throne room of God into this realm to fulfill a mission. Amen. Everyone. Every human being came from the Spirit of God. That's why we love to get high. Because we came from the Most High, right? Praise God. The greatest high, the greatest feeling, the greatest emotional feeling that you can ever partake is in God's presence. There isn't anything that can compare. No matter how much dope, no matter how much sex, no matter how much money, no matter how many successful businesses you've had, it don't mean nothing. Doesn't matter how many things that you've done, you will never be fulfilled without God's presence. Amen. And in the old covenant, what they used to do, everything was associated with ordinances and rituals. You know, they had to sacrifice animals and things to that degree. When Jesus came, he paid a specific, powerful price. And one of the things that he did is he came to exchange his presence. And when he exchanged his presence, you and I now have access to the Holy Spirit. So everything, Holy Spirit representation, holy breath. Holy breath. So everything now is not done by physical battle, it's done by spiritual battle. In other words, it's basically the battle of breath. Does everybody get this? So in other words, when God spoke, his words don't fall to the ground. So when he spoke, his words are still going. In fact, that's what's sustaining you and me. His words hold everything. I could hold this Bible up right now. Amen. It's training manual. God's word holds the whole creation and universe. It still holds it. If his word stopped, so would everything else. So his word continues to go, doesn't it? So when you get in the stream of his words, of his life, and you begin to speak those things that he's speaking, things begin to change because everything is activated by speaking now. So if I speak his words, there is a law that God has released that says what you sow is what you reap. In other words, what I speak is what I eat. What I eat is what I become. So you cannot change by just saying, God, change me. You change by cooperation, which is the price. So when you're speaking God's words that are life, you're actually eating them. Your mind changes. Everything begins to change. You become healthier. You become stronger. Everything begins to change. Why? Because I'm in the stream which God has created for me to get into. We call it the river of life. It's the stream of life. He says, my words are life. So when you and I praise and worship the Lord, when you choose not to, it's just an interruption from the enemy because he knows that if you speak the words, you're going to change. And as you change, he begins to fear you because you're not changing into anyone else but into Christ, his character, and his divine nature. So the enemy will do everything he can to get you to listen to secular music so you sing the demon songs and you become more like a demon. Then you love the things of the world. You become lustful, prideful, arrogant, disobedient, rebellious, because those are the presence of evil. Every presence of evil has a fruit. But when the presence of God comes, there's submission, there's worship, there's love, there's surrender. There's no more survival. There's surrender. There is a voice that he begins to speak to you. and you are led. You're no longer misled. There is a place that God wants me and you to be. Does everybody get it? That's a place of freedom. Because the word says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. That's where the Spirit of breath is. So when you're walking in the Spirit, you're actually walking in the breath of God. He's actually breathing through you now. Has everybody got it? Good. I said all that to get to somewhere. Revelation chapter 1. You know, we have these powerful prayer booklets that are called penetrating prayers. Why are they penetrating prayers? Because they penetrate the physical realm into the spiritual realm to push back evil so that you eat light and change. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 12. Let's speak it. Then I turned to see the voice that what?
Spoke.
With me. That did what? Spoke with me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like a son of man, clothed with a garment down to the feet and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and hair were like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like flames of fire. This is Jesus. He don't look like what he used to look like. Hello. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice was the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand seven stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp, two-edged sword. So when you speak his words, a sword comes out of your mouth. Does everybody see? That's why the enemy don't want you, because every time you speak, he's ducking. They run. They run from you. And his countenance was like the sun shining in the strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forever." Amen. "And I have the keys of Hades and of death. Write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after this." In other words, he has the keys of Hades. Hades was known as hell. Hell. It's a place of separation from God. In other words, a key opens and shuts, doesn't it? It locks and unlocks. He says, "I have the keys now. I have the keys. I can unlock and lock. I have the keys of not only hell," which opens the door of hell to release souls, "but it also can send them to hell too." Everybody got it? See, when Jesus died, he descended into the depths. He went to hell. He could only go to hell because he received man's sin, because you can't enter hell without sin. So he took all of mankind's sin and he went to hell. When he went to hell, he ministered to them. He said, "Look it, I am he who was, who is, and who is to come. I am your Savior. Accept me and you can come out today." He gave everybody an opportunity to leave. He also opened paradise, which was a place in Hades, but it was not hell. It was not a place of torment. It was a place of waiting, of rest. Until Jesus, because when Jesus opened heaven, now when he died on the cross, he not only opened hell to release those, but he opened heaven for them to go there. Does everybody get it? So he released those from paradise that were waiting to go to heaven, and he also gave an opportunity for those in hell to come out. And many didn't, because they still believed the lie of Satan's kingdom. But many came out. And they went home. He preached salvation to them. And so he says, "I hold the keys of Hades," or hell. And "I also hold the keys of death." In other words, he now holds the key of life. He holds the key of death, which you and I were destined to die. Now we can live forever. So he holds not only the key of hell that opens and closes the door, but he also holds the key of life and death now. Does everybody got that? These keys are representation because of his authority. I now have authority. Do you understand that? Do you understand that you have been given keys of authority? That's what we're going to talk about. So, keys of authority. Now, Jesus did not get these keys without a price, did he? And you don't get keys without a price either. Amen? These keys were paid with cooperation with the will of God. That's why they're called keys of authority. Does everybody get this? Keys of authority. In Revelation 3, in verse 7. Everyone look at your neighbor and tell them, you got keys of authority. If you cooperate. And verse 7, let's speak it together. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write these things, says he who is holy, who is, and who has what? Who is true and who has the what? Key of David, he who opens and no one shuts, and shuts, and no one opens. I know your works. See, I have set you before an open door, and no one can shut it. For you have a little strength, have kept my word, and have not denied my name. This was the price, wasn't it? Even though you had a little strength, you've kept my word, and you've not denied my name. Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan, who say they are Jews and are not, or say they are Christians and are not, but lie. Indeed, I will, what? Make them come and what? Worship before your feet. They will bow to you. Why? Because they will bow to the name of Jesus. Come and worship before your feet and to know that I have loved you. Why? Because he's going to show that he's given you authority. Because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which will come upon the whole world. And it's not come yet, but it's coming. To test those who dwell on the earth. Behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast what you have, that no one may take your crown. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of my God and the new city, Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from God, and I will write him my new name. See, there's a Jerusalem that isn't dimensionals away that is there. That's where people die. That are believers, that's where they go. Does everybody get it? Eventually, everything is going to dissolve in this universe, and the new Jerusalem will come, a place where you and I will inhabit. But during the millennium year, the thousand-year reign, the new Jerusalem will still be there. That's why you must have a glorified body so that you can go back and forth to the earth and to home, Jerusalem. Has everybody got it? There'll be a Jerusalem on the earth, but there's a true Jerusalem that's as big as the earth. It says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So we need to have an ear to hear, right? We need to have this ear. Again, the key of cooperation results in authority. Does everybody get it? That's why he said, come and learn from me. We have a t-shirt that says, learn or burn. See, if you're not willing to learn, you're going to get burned. The enemy is going to use you to burn someone else, and you can eternally burn. So you can have all the things of the world and still go to hell. Somebody got it? In Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9. God wants to restore your identity before you came. Does everybody get it? He wants to restore you before you came here. Because you are sons and daughters of the Most High God. Your identity was one with Him, with authority and with power. See, He gave it all up to come. So did you. It says we were with Him before we came. But at the moment you were conceived, you lost all memory. That's why when we're here on this earth, we're trying to figure out, who the heck am I? Why am I here and where am I going? I'm on a planet and I'm stranded. Don't know how to get out of here. But there's influence all around me that tries to give me a false identity, preventing from me to get my true identity. And believe me, once you get your identity, the enemy still tries to come and exchange it and steal it. Your battle is maintaining who you are in Christ. But there is a fight. Again, it is the fight of breath, isn't it? It's called spiritual warfare, means breath warfare. Now, this breath warfare does not mean how much you eat garlic. Amen. Or how many onions you ate. You're not going to cast no devil out with bad breath. You may remove people from your presence. But the only breath that you can remove a demon with is the true breath of God. Does everybody get it? The true breath of God. And that true breath of God is carried with His words, which is a sword. Is everybody okay? Praise God. Luke 9:23. Is everybody there? And He said to them what? All. If what? Anyone desires to come after Me, let him what? Deny himself and take his cross and follow Me. That is the first key to authority. Maintaining you are always out of the way. You as a person. You as the self. You as the old conduct. He says you must deny yourself, which is your old nature, and put on the new divine nature. Deny yourself. Pick up His cross, which is the sword. Amen, to fight, and then you're able to follow. Verse 24, for whoever what? Desires to save his life will what? Lose it. But whoever loses his life for My sake will what? Save it. Wow. Whoever desires to save his life is going to lose it. That's why people fight for the life. It's called survival instead of surrender their life, which is surrender. Whoever, for what profit is it a man if he gains the whole world and he himself is destroyed or lost? Whoever is ashamed of Me and My words, of him the Son of Man will be ashamed when He comes in His glory and his Father and the holy angels. But I tell you truly that there are some standing here who shall not taste death till they see the kingdom of God. Again, denying the self is the first key to authority. Amen? And it's going to take cooperation. Deny. What happens when we deny the old nature, we replace it with the divine nature. When you deny yourself, you connect. You cannot stay connected to God if you're still not denying yourself. See, denying yourself says, I remove Me for Him. I remove My, I don't lean on My understanding anymore. I don't lean on Me, I lean on Him. He is my source and everything else is a resource. I'm leaning everything on Him, I'm trusting Him in everything. Let me give you an example. Go to 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings 19. Verse 13. Now there was a powerful prophet called Elijah. And it says here in verse 13, it says, so it was when Elijah had heard the Lord tell him, in other words, the Lord told him what to do, He gave him a command, that he wrapped his face in his mantle and he went out and he stood in the entrance of a cave. And suddenly a voice came to him, of course this was the Lord, and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here? In other words, who told you that? Who told you that? And he said, I've been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts because the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they seek to take my life. Then the Lord said to him, go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, anoint Hazael as king over Syria. Also, you shall anoint Jehu, the son of Nishai, as king over Israel, and Elijah, the son of Shaphat, Abel-Mahali, you shall anoint as prophet in your place. It shall be that whoever escapes the sword of Hazael, Jehu will kill, and whoever escapes the sword of Jehu, Elisha will kill. Again, this was more physical, wasn't it? The battle was physical. Now our battle is spiritual, because they were being influenced by demonic forces in the physical. Now you and I can attack what's being influencing the people. Does everybody get it? You and I attack the root of it now by the spirit of breath of God. Amen? Yet I have reserved 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed to Baal, who is a fallen angel, and every mouth that has not kissed him. These are false deities. That's what fallen angels become. They become gods and goddesses, and they deceive people. So he departed from there, and he found Elijah, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen before him. Now here was this gentleman, Elijah. He was plowing. He had 12 oxen. At that time, to own 12 oxen, 12 yoke, I'm sorry. So that gives him 24 oxen. 12 yoke. That means he was very, very wealthy. His family was very wealthy. Does everybody got it? Now, the number 12 yoke, now 12 means governmental, spiritually. It's associated with government. And it says that he had 12 yoke of oxen, giving him 24 oxen. And he was with the 12. Then Elijah passed by him and threw his mantle on him. Now, a mantle was known as covering, but when you're covered by the Lord, you carry a mantle. The mantle we call now the anointing of God. The anointing of God is the eternal presence, power, and truth of God carried by the Holy Spirit now. So he becomes the mantle in your life. So what happens is when God calls you, he draws you. The anointing draws. Amen? The anointing draws you. He says, no man come to the Father unless he first be drawn. So what he did is he invited you. He invited you. Now you have the choice, because God will never interfere. He will not force you to take his invitation. But you'd have to be a real idiot not to. Anyways. So he invited Elijah, right? Elisha. So what did Elisha do? Watch this in verse 20. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah, and he said, please let me go kiss my mommy and my daddy, and then I will follow you. Now watch what Elijah says. I love this. What does he say? And he said to him, go back again. What have I done to you? What have I done to you? See, he wanted to go back and fix things up with family. But God says, when I call you, you come to me, I'll fix your past. I'll prepare your future. Does everybody get it? I'll fix your past. I'll set you straight in the present. I'll lay out your future. But don't you dare look behind again. Because you can't follow me if you do. Amen. Has everybody got that? So that's called denying yourself. Now wait a minute. He still had a choice now, didn't he? Amen. So what did he showed? He showed God. He showed Elijah that he was willing to accept the call. He said, okay, I got it. Gotcha. I'm coming. So verse 21. So Elisha turned back from him, took a yoke of oxen and slaughtered them and boiled their flesh using the oxen's equipment and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he rose and he followed Elijah and became his servant. What did he do? Man, he took everything that he was relying on, his source of everything, and he destroyed it so he could no longer lean on the old, so that he could lean on the new. See, before I got freed, before the Lord came and visited me and took me, I was crying out one day. He said, the Lord said to me, this voice came to me, and I didn't know it was the Lord at first. He said, Guy, do you want to be free? I said, yeah. He says, well, you must show me you're willing to be free. You must show me. Show me. Show me. He said, are you willing to do whatever it takes? Show me you're willing to do whatever it takes. And I know, he said, in that expression, he was saying, you got to give up everything. You got to give it all up. You got to give up the way you used to think, the way you used to live, and the people you used to associate with. You got to give it all up. Because if you're not willing to do that, you can't follow me. So he challenged me. And believe me, he'll challenge you. Are you willing to give it up? You got to give up the music. You got to give up those programs that you used to watch. All those things that are sourced by Satan's kingdom and evil, you got to give up. And take me as the source of everything. Your music, your fellowship, your movies. Does everybody get this? You got to take me as your source. And if you're willing to allow me to be your source, I'll free you. Has everybody got it? See, I knew that challenge, I couldn't go back. And for me, it was almost, gosh, I mean, many of us have burned so many bridges in our life, there was nothing to go back to. But as bridges begin to get restored in your life, you're still not supposed to go back. He's to be your source in everything. See, that's the deception of the enemy, because his greatest weapon is deception. As soon as things start going great, people think, oh, okay, I'm good now. It's called pride. None of us is good. None of us is made it until we get before him and he says, enter my good and faithful servant. Other than that, there is no guarantee. Amen? Is everybody okay? Oh, glory. Destroy what? Build your old life. And allow God to build your new life. Amen? Even the number 12, meaning governmental, the Lord says, come out from among them and be separate and don't touch what is unclean and I'll be a father to you. See, we have a ruling of government here. And I'm not saying go out and disobey the law, but you're under a higher law. You're under another authority now. See, they'll try to stop you from speaking about Jesus, but you're under a higher authority. They may have their laws that come against the kingdom of God, but I'm under a higher authority. Far be it that I should allow man to bring fear to me. Does everybody understand that? See, we don't fear man. We reverence him. We're not men pleasers. We're God pleasers. When he showed about killing, okay, when he killed the oxen and he took the plow because that was his source of income, the equipment. Kill is a representation of fight. So, see, in the old covenant, when they killed one another, they were fighting, right? And the new covenant, it's now fight in spiritual realm. See, so you got to fight in the spiritual realm, constantly beating off the old so that you can maintain new all the time. See, new feeds on new. Amen. 2 Timothy, yes, chapter 2. 2 Timothy 2. So that's why we call it, there's a spiritual fight. It's called spiritual warfare with spiritual authority. And God has given us keys of authority if we use them right. And 2 Timothy chapter 2. Is everybody okay? So if you don't learn, you're going to get burned, right? Everything is about training, isn't it? Training. If you're not willing to be trained, you're going to be easily deceived. You'll stay in the cycle of deception. In verse 1, 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 1. Would you read it with me? You therefore, my son, be what? Strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. The word grace means God's plan. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to what? Faithful men who will be able to teach others. See, that's training, isn't it? Teaching is training. So what you are learning, you should be able to teach. This is not just come and get goosebumps. Amen. This is not just fellowship. It's a place to be trained up, because everything that you are learning here, you should be thinking, how can I teach what I'm learning? Does everybody get it? See, so whether you accept it or not, you're accountable for everything you hear. Amen? Because you will stand before God and he'll say, you were there when I told you. Don't look at the man speaking. Think of the anointing that speaks to us. He said, so make sure you get others that are able to teach. Verse 3, would you read it with me? You therefore must what? Endure hardship as a good what? Soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare, spiritual warfare, entangles himself with the affairs of this life. In other words, the old stuff again. That he may please him who has enlisted him as a what? As a soldier. Wow. As a what? Soldier. A soldier in the spirit should not engage in a worldliness like dependence on the world. We do not depend on the world. Amen. We are dependent on the Lord as the source of all things. Will he use his resources in this world? Yes. But you go to the source. That's why the word says, seek ye the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things will be added to you. So when you begin to acknowledge him as the source, you know that he's going to connect his resources on this side. That's why you give him glory, because he's the one that arranged it, not me or you. Amen. Go to Matthew 16. Matthew 16 and verse 19. Matthew 16, verse 19. Would you read this with me? Actually, let's go to verse 18. And he says, and I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. He was talking about the anointing. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. This wasn't Peter or Pope. There was no such thing. Amen? It's all religious garbage. People going around kissing a man. That's plumb stinking ridiculous. Praying to saints like they can hear you. That's all enemy's tactics. Everybody get that? Anything to interrupt you direct contact and making and maintaining contact with the one created you. And he says this in verse 19. And I will give you what? The keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. In other words, I'm going to give you the keys of authority. What an honor. What a blessing. Now you got to learn to use them. Because if you don't know how to use them, you'll lose it. And you go back right into deception. Get sucked back into the world. Amen? Go to 2 Corinthians 4. What's the keys for? They're spiritual authority. They're keys of authority to fight. So that you are victorious in everything. So that you are not overcome by deception and temptations. 2 Corinthians 4. In verse 7. Let's speak it. But we have this what? Treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. Hello. That may be of God and not of us. So you got to constantly take off you. Amen? Now the enemy's always going to try and promote you so that you get in front. Because then it's me, 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 me. Mine, 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 mine. I. I'm always first. What about me? Woe is me. And all of me's. You got to get rid of me. It's you. But you can't have that unless you're connected. That's why God says connect. And that all connection starts with abiding. We'll talk about that. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 7. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are what? Hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Why are you hard pressed? Because the powers of darkness are pressing on you all the time. Yes, there's demons all around. We are persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. Does everybody see that? So that the power of God may be expressed, the divine nature expressed, and not our own strength. We are soldiers in the Spirit. We have keys of authority, and we need to use them. But if you don't know who you are, see, you can't know who you are without being connected. If you don't know who you are truly, then you're disconnected. And there are people proclaiming to be believers who've never been connected for 30 and 40 years. But they still go to church, they pay their tithes, but they've never really been connected. They've been religious, but not connected. Amen? Hosea 4:6. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. Is everybody there? Amen. So this power that is in me and you, in fact, the word says that he who is in us is greater than he who is in the world, and that we are more than conquerors. But if you don't know who you are, you won't be. And let me tell you, the powers of darkness who read your thoughts, they know what you think. They know whether you know who you are. They know how to step in and deceive you. Does everybody get it? They know how to set traps. They know how to sway you. They know. See, they know that when they speak something and you talk to them, oh, we got them. See, that's why you and I are to discern the voice of the stranger and the voice of God. Amen. See, what they do is they speak something out. And if you pay attention to it and grab hold of it and begin to commune with it, then they begin to speak louder and clearer. And there's a fruit then that comes. The fruit of association with the presence of evil is always self. Pride, rebellion, arrogance, all the other things. Offense. All those foolish things that separate. Lust. People become a lustafarian. Hallelujah. Become hunters. Hosea 4:6. Is everybody there? Would you speak it with me? My people are what? Destroyed for lack of knowledge. This knowledge is eternal information. Everybody say that. Knowledge is eternal information. And he says, because you've rejected eternal information, I'll reject you from being a what? Priest for me, which is somebody close. Because you have forgotten the law of your God, I will forget your children. Why? Because a curse comes on you and down your family line. Everybody got it? Again, to be connected, you must abide. If you're not willing to abide, you can't be connected. Amen. Does everybody get this? This is a key of knowledge. Knowledge is information. It is eternal information. It is from the eternal order of God. It's a knowledge. Now, when knowledge is understood, it becomes truth. If knowledge is not understood, it becomes confusion. Has everybody got it? So knowledge, when it is understood, becomes truth. Now, when the truth is used, practiced, implemented, it creates freedom. So, does everybody get this? So, if I was to take information from eternal information and correctly interpret it, I'd have understanding. If I use that information, it's going to create an atmosphere of freedom. And if I begin to speak that information, it's going to create freedom in me because it's going to start driving out spirits. It's going to start driving out deception. It will start replacing deception with truth. Does everybody get this? Why? Because I'm cooperating with the breath of God. Amen? I'm cooperating with the breath of God. But if I get this eternal information called knowledge, and I have understanding of it, and put it on the shelf, nothing's going to happen. Amen. So knowledge that is understood becomes truth. Knowledge not understood brings confusion. Truth put into practice brings freedom. Many have knowledge. Many have truth. Amen? But no depth of understanding because they're really not connected. Only connection can bring interpretation to understand. That's why I've talked with many, oh man, I've read the Bible 4 or 5 times. But they ain't free. See, you can read the Bible 4 or 5 times and still have no understanding. Amen? The only one that can bring you understanding is the Holy Spirit. Because he's the one that wrote it, and he's the one that brings interpretation. Amen? Would you turn to John 16 with me? And what are keys of authority? That's because you're connected to bind and loose. You're given authority to attack. Amen? You're given authority to drive out. You're given authority. Amen? But you got to be connected so that you maintain identity, don't you? Because if you don't know who you are, you're lost. Living outside of salvation's truth, L-O-S-T. And John 16 and verse 12. John 16, verse 12. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. Jesus is speaking to them. He said, man, you can't get it. I know. And now Jesus is standing in front of them. The truth. The person of truth. The word that became flesh. He's speaking to them. And he said, look, man, there's things I got to tell you, but you ain't going to get it. You will not be able to interpret what I'm telling you. I said, I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, who's known as the Holy Spirit, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but he will, whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. Now, that's powerful. In other words, he's going to interpret. He's going to be the one that brings you understanding of the eternal information. Amen? Now, that can't happen unless there's connection. So there's got to be connection. So everybody got it? Go to Luke 11. It's going to take cooperation, isn't it? The Holy Spirit is the connector of all understanding and interpretation because of the price Jesus paid for me and you. I'm going to say that again. He is the connector of all understanding and interpretation because of the price that Jesus paid. In Luke 11, in verse 46, oh, hallelujah. Jesus is speaking. He says, woe to you. Woe is without eternity. It doesn't mean hold back a horse. It's woe. Woe to you also, lawyers, for you load men with burdens hard to bear, and you yourselves do not touch the burdens with one of your fingers. Woe to you, for you build the tombs of the prophets, and your fathers kill them. In fact, you bear witness that you approve the deeds of your fathers, for they indeed killed them, and you built their tombs. Therefore, the wisdom of God also said, I will send them prophets and apostles, and some of them they will kill and persecute, that the blood of all the prophets which was shed from the foundation of the world may be required of this generation. From the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, who perished between the altar and the temple. Yes, I say to you, it shall be required of this generation. Woe to you, lawyers, for you have taken away the what? Key of knowledge, or the key of eternal information. You did not enter in yourselves, and those who were entering in you, what? Hindered. In other words, lawyers are associated with Pharisees and scribes. They were lawmakers of the spiritual information, the eternal information that had been given to them. And they did not release it all. They hindered it. Has everybody got it? They hid it. They held it back from the people. And that's what, so that they could have control. That's called religion. Amen? So that they could have control over religion. I remember going to school, Catholicism and stuff. You know, I never knew about it. I never knew about Bible study. You know, they would quote a few scriptures at a service or whatever and did their rituals. But there was really no training or teaching. Amen. Not when I was a kid. There was never any training or teaching. I didn't know of any place that was training and teaching. You know, everything was all rituals. You do the ritual, you give some money, and you're gone. You back to your old life. Nothing was changed because nobody imparted any real truth. Amen. So that's what we call religion, because religion controls. And what it does is they have... It holds back true information to set people free. Listen, deception rules, doesn't it? Deception rules this world. The author of deception is Satan's kingdom. His greatest weapon is deception, and his power is fear. Still rules this world. People are still caught under. Look at all religions that are out there. Think about them all. There's so many religions that people won't. They're starving in other countries, and they won't eat the animal because it could be grandma. I mean, think about that. I mean, there's so many stinking religions out there, it's ridiculous. All these religions end up in hell. Only Jesus ends up in heaven, because Jesus is not about religion, he's about kingdom business. Because he's trying to restore us where we came from and give us the keys of authority so we can kick some butt. Amen? Amen? Amen. By the Holy Spirit, you carry the key. So what is he saying? He said, man, these guys held back all of this eternal knowledge. They held back all of this, and they held back the one who's going to help you interpret so you have understanding. All of this eternal information. They were holding back because they wanted control. And then they were holding back the one that would interpret it for you and give you understanding, called the Holy Spirit. That's why in the book of Acts, in chapter 1, it says, and you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Amen? And then you'll be my witnesses. Why? Because power is representation of authority. See, God wants you to operate in the keys of authority. Amen? There's too many wimps in the kingdom, man. It's time to man up and woman up. Stand up, get filled up, and cut loose of your past, and use the things that God has given us, and be connected with relationship with him. That's why he says it's important that we abide. Amen? Abide. He will give you and me wisdom. Now, wisdom tells you what to do. Understanding tells you how to do it. Amen? These are eternal things. Go to James chapter 3 for a minute. Is everybody okay? Amen. Are you with us? Yes. Are you with him? Amen. Glory. James chapter 3. In verse 13. Is everybody there? James 3:13. Everyone say it. Whoa. Here we go again. Oh, who is? Sorry. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by what? Good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of what? Wisdom. But if you have bitter envy, self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but it is what? Earthly, sensual, and what? Demonic. That's powerful. Demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. But the wisdom that is from above is first what? Pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Wisdom tells what to do. Understanding tells how to do it. Using eternal information which releases your identity in Christ and authority in Christ gives you the keys of authority to use them. Has everybody got it? What did Jesus say in Matthew 28? He said, go make disciples. Go make disciples. And I'm with you. Go make disciples. I've given you authority. Go make disciples. Go train them up. Amen? Go train them up. In John 15. He's given me and you authority. Jesus said, I've come to bring life and life abundantly. But the thief has come to steal, kill, and destroy. So you and I are to remove this thief so he doesn't steal, kill, and destroy anymore. And he does it by what? Deception. He wants to steal your identity. He wants to replace truth with deception, bring you into bondage so that you fall back into the world and you begin to rely back on yourself instead of him. John 15, is everybody there? And we're going to start at verse 1. Would you read it? Jesus said what? I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Now, what he means by this, because a tree represents a spirit or a human. His. Every tree, every person that doesn't bear good fruit will be removed. Amen? Every tree in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes. So you're going to get squeezed to bear more. You're going to get trained to bear more. That he may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it what? Abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. So there's an abiding arena. Again, we talk about abiding. Well, you abide in prayer. You abide in God's word. You abide in praise and worship. Think about praise and worship. It's not humming. It's not this. It's this. Out of your mouth. Why? Because it is the ministry of the Spirit. You are sowing, you are eating, you are changing. You're actually changing the atmosphere. Demons are running because they can't stand God's presence. And you know where they go? To everyone that ain't worshiping. Yes. So make sure the person next to you ain't worshiping. You're, worship, bro. Get those things out of you because I don't want to have to deal with them. See, the demons know whether you are sealed or not. They see that seal on you. They can't get near you if your seal is bright. So you know what they have to do? Get in someone else to get near to you. Hallelujah. So we need to abide, don't we? Cool. All right, I'm going to close at Mark 16. Authority. Keys of authority. If you don't learn, you get what? Burned. And this is not about going to college and learning something, amen? This is eternal college. Amen. This is spiritual warfare. This is reality. This is truth. Because you're being influenced by an unseen realm. We don't look at the things that are seen, but the things that are unseen. In Mark 16, is everybody there? Powerful scripture. He who what? Believes. What's the word believe mean? Follow. So you're not going to just sit there, hi, I believe, but not abide. Because God said, you a liar. You ain't even going to, you don't even seek me. You don't pray. You don't read my word. You don't believe me. And then I don't know you. See, if you don't follow, you can't be connected. If you're still doing your own thing, you can't be connected. You're lost. It's real simple. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. He who does not believe or follow will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name they will what? Cast out demons. They will force them out of them, others, atmosphere, so forth. Force them out. Why? Because you've got to force them out to bring the presence of God. It's our responsibility to make room for Daddy. Says that they will cast out demons and they will speak with new tongues. That's getting baptized in the Holy Spirit, where you get a new breath because you get a new language. And they will take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly or by no means hurt them, that doesn't mean you're going to test God. Amen. Like go out and drink gasoline and say, well, Lord says, too late, dummy. They got all these religions now. I don't know if you've ever seen them. I've seen them on the news one day. Blew me away. There's these people dancing with serpents. Amen. They're drinking cyanide. Well, the word says this. We believe it. There was no truth. There can't be the Holy Spirit there because that wasn't the correct interpretation. So you talk. Then they interviewed them afterwards, and there's these little kids there. Where's your mom? Drank cyanide. Where's your dad? He was dancing with a serpent. No more mom and dad. Dumb. That's testing God. Amen? In other words, where was the relationship? None. They fell into religion, didn't they? Amen? It says, you will take up serpents. That means demonic forces. And if you drink anything deadly, that means if anything by mistake, you have authority to overcome. Amen? Believe me, there's been things that somebody cooked for me. And I said, Lord, I'm going to die. Not you, hon. It's okay. You know, you go to a restaurant, you ate something, it was like, oh! You know. Anyway. Hallelujah. When my wife brings something out that I know I ain't got, let's go to dinner. wisdom. I mean, come on, hon, I'll take you to dinner tonight. You can put that in a refrigerator. Ready. Praise God. But man, I ate something I knew was like, the chicken wasn't fully cooked or something. It was like, you know, he crunched into it and went, and you get, Lord, you said I could eat anything and drink anything and will not hurt me. That's what you use it for, amen? It doesn't mean you're going to go out and drink cyanide and pick up dead animals and eat them. And they will lay hands on the sick. And they will recover. Hallelujah. Sometimes you need to lay hands on yourself. I baptized myself many times in the tub. Man, I'd be struggling. I said, that's it, Lord. Baptize me again. Hold me down as long as you need to. Why? I want to die to myself. I don't want to hang out with anything in the old. Everything in the new. Take the authority. Look at you and I have been given keys, but if you're not willing to learn, you're going to get cooked. You're going to get deceived, rolled over again. You'll be crying to God, oh, why not? He said, man, I set you in a place to learn. You know, every time God rescues us, he puts us in a place to learn. What are you going to do with it now? Are you going to take what you learned here today and just put it on the shelf again? Or are you going to put it into action? Are you going to make a commitment to God? You're willing to do whatever it takes. Amen? Are you going to still be entangled in the affairs of this world and be used as the devil as a welcome mat to hell? Amen? To his hell. You know, people are looking at people. They're looking. People are looking at you. You claim to be a Christian. They're waiting for you to blow it. But he who's in you is greater than he who's in the world. You walk in a power because you're abiding. No weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue that rises up against you will be exposed, condemned, and removed. So we need to have the wisdom. We've got the knowledge. We need the Holy Spirit, right? To interpret. Without relationship, without being connected, you're disconnected. You must stay connected. And that's what the enemy wants to do. Disconnect you. He'll replace the voice of God with the voice of a stranger, and you'll find yourself astray. Amen? Amen. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it because he's faithful to complete what he started. He just trained us. He just gave us nuggets from the throne room. It's the anointing that teaches us, not men. I want to be taught by the anointing, not some religious idiot. Amen? Amen? There's enough of that going around now. People aren't willing to stand up for the truth. And those of you that are watching, get out and vote. And don't vote for Hillary, you idiot. Let's lift our hands to heaven. Father, we give you all the glory and all the honor and all the grace. You are God. You are King. You are Lord. There's no one like you. None. We love to praise you. We love your presence. We love you. Lord, help those that are approving of the things that are wrong. Connect them to your spirit that they would have correct interpretation of what you're saying. We ask, Lord, that you'll bring revival. Bring revival. Come, Holy Spirit. Counsel, correct, convict, change, turn hearts, Lord. Make yourself real. As we prepare our hearts for communion, Lord, we ask for your touch and for your change. In Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.